crazy. Just a forensic. It should just
end up with that. Thank you so much for your patience. I'm very sorry about the traffic. I'm glad you're all here and you've all made it, and our speakers have made it as well. We're absolutely delighted to have Pam Cave and Ella Saltmarsh here tonight. They've been running an incredible course and teaching our students over the last few days into incredible states of inspiration. And we're really happy to have them here tonight as well for an audience such as yourself. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So on this beautiful gift that was given to me as I was coming in, I'd like to sing an invocation song here for us all to invite in the larger community and the wisdom of the larger community of all the life and our spiritual helpers and our ancestors. So this is some of you know this song, it's a grandmother calling song. Land of my heart, and feels like a homecoming to be here for me. So I want to say thank you to this land for the way that it holds and nourishes all of us sitting here, and how special this land is, and the people are here. It's good to see so many friends and fellow journeyers. We've been on some adventures here together, all of us here. So thank you so much. So pleased and honored that you're here. Thank you for coming. And I just wanted to introduce myself. My mama named me Patricia Catherine McCabe. There's a story behind that. I won't go into that quite right now. but also, well, I should say I come from Diné Nation. So I'll say, She'e'iya, tachi nishni, aro ashi imbashish chi, ma edish geshne dashe nare, klaus chi daush che, batao thani nishni. I always like to let that ancient language, that vibration, meet the ancient language of this land, ancient languages probably of this land. And I was adopted into the Lakota spiritual way of life about almost 30 years ago. And in that way, I was given the name Wiyakpa Najiwi, which translates roughly to womaning, standing, shining. And I live in what we now call the United States and what we now call New Mexico, in northern New Mexico. And it's my great honor to be here. It's been my great honor to be meeting with economy and ecology students, with the horticulture growers, and then this week with our short course, a short course on the long time. So, but we got it in there. And a really, really great honor to be working with Ella for the first time and seeing how our view of how the long time can be our ally in so many different ways and can open up vistas from different perspectives and weaving that together. So at this point, I'll turn it over to Ella. Yeah.
Great. Thank you, Pat. Oh, it has been such a joy to hear your songs and the songs of your ancestors over these last days. Hello, everyone. My name is Ella Saltmarsh. I am from this place. I grew up here. I went to Dartington Primary School. I danced around a maypole in the gardens as a child. I worked in the White Hart pub during my university holidays. I did my first course at Schumacher about 23 years ago, and have recently come home again. So it's also been a really meaningful time being here, learning from and with our long-time keepers on the program and from and with Pat. So we have got this evening this time to have a shared inquiry into what it means to be a good ancestor. And we're going to, as seems to be our want, we are going to fit lots of different things into this time we've got together. So Pat and I are each going to talk to you a little bit. We're going to talk to each other. We are going to get you all to do a long time practice together. And then we will have a wider conversation. So that's the shape of our time together. And so I thought I'd start by talking about how I started on this long time road. And it began not very far away from where we're sitting. In my mum's house in Totnes on a very rainy Saturday afternoon, and I was looking after my little nephew, who was about 2 at the time. And as I've shared with the course participants, he was a child who was obsessed by doors, by like car doors, shower doors, I don't know, kitchen doors, boiler doors. And so this afternoon that I was looking after him, he was playing with a really big cupboard door. And I didn't think anything of it because doors was where they were his thing. And while he was doing that, I was reading an article about climate change. I'd already been working professionally on climate change for about 13 years at this point. And it was an article that we're probably all quite familiar with that was talking about the terrifying statistics for the end of this century. And suddenly I heard a noise and I looked up and I saw that my tiny nephew was about to pull this massive cupboard down on him. It's like I dropped the article, I jumped up, I pushed the cupboard up, I scooped him up. He started screaming at the injustice of being taken away from the most fun game in the universe. And to both of our surprise, I started to weep too. because in that moment, I suddenly realized that the world he was reading, I was reading about, was the world he would be living in, and that I was not going to be there to scoop him up from danger. And something in me changed in that moment. And for the first time in my life, I understood myself to be an ancestor. And I didn't have children of my own, but that didn't matter. And I can't kind of put into words what a shift that was inside of me. As I say, even though the issues weren't new to me, and so I became curious. I wondered if thinking of oneself as an ancestor could be as potent for other people as it was for me. And so I got together with a friend and we started to mess about with intention. We began to convene people around this question of what it means to be a good ancestor. As I shared on the course, we didn't have the answers. And to be honest, most of the time, I still feel like I don't have the answers. But what I've learned through life is that rather than waiting to have the right answers and then trying to impose them on the world, it is far more fruitful to build community around questions. And so that is what we are doing this evening. We are growing the community around this question of what it means to be a good ancestor. So in those early days, we grew this community. We were quite intentional. We wanted to invite people who were already doing interesting things with time. So we invited deep time experts, astrophysicists, all kinds of artists, ecologists. And we ran some residential courses. We ran some nights that were dinners, bringing people together. And all of this was testing the waters. It was like, is there something here? Is there something here? Is this valuable? And we kept finding that, yes, it was valuable, that the people who'd come would go on and like change their life course. In someone who's worked on climate for so long, it was kind of crazy. It was like we've been trying to get people to change for so many years, and then there was something about this question that seemed to shift the ground profoundly for people. And I guess as I dive deeper into that work, I started to understand a bit more about why this question of being a good ancestor was so transformative. So one of the interesting things when you start looking at the data is if you look at the value of stewardship, it is a value that is shared by people on the left and the right of the political spectrum. It's one of the few shared values. So this idea of being a steward, of caring for the future, can allow us to transcend political division. It doesn't mean that the answers aren't political. Many of the answers and solutions are political. But it means that we can engage with people not from their politics, but from something deeper. And so we began to grow the community around this question. We began by growing it within government. So we started to work with local authorities in different parts of the UK, with national governments like the Canadian government, the New Zealand government, with regional governments. And we grew the community around the question. We brought people together. We got them to design tools that they could use in their own institutions to help them care for the future. So the question that we were convening around is, how can we evolve our institutions so they care for the future? So that work started to flourish and grow. And we always began our work with a practice. So I'll share one of those practices later. But we were really clear that we had to engage policymakers as ancestors before we engaged them as policymakers. We had to engage them with their humanity. And so then we thought, well, okay, we're doing work within some of the kind of places where traditional power lies. What does it look like to start to widen the community of this conversation out to the public? And we realized that popular culture is going to be a good way of doing that. My background is systems and culture, and so I'm constantly thinking about the kinds of partnerships that will bring scale and reach and depth to issues. And so our dream partner was Headspace, the meditation app, because it felt that there was values alignment, but also because they had a community of 30 million users. We were like, yeah, that's a lot of people. And because we were both us and Headspace, were really interested in this question of how do you move people from thinking about their individual well-being to thinking about their collective well-being? And so the Longtime Academy podcast was born. With each episode comes an individual practice. The idea being, as we have been doing on the course over these last few days, that we get to embody the ideas we hear about on the podcast. In the podcast, we hear from the people who are already bringing this long-timeism into their institutions. So we hear from Julia Olson, the lawyer who started Our Children's Trust, and some of the children that she is supporting to sue their governments. We hear from Jane Davidson, who wrote the groundbreaking Wellbeing for Future Generations Act in Wales, the first law of its kind in the world that means that all public bodies in Wales have to take future generations into account in their work. We hear from people like Kate Raworth, who are challenging the economic orthodoxy, and from people doing donor economics, economics for the long term, on the ground in Costa Rica, in Birmingham, in LA. And so the process of making this podcast was one of, firstly, kind of revealing how the systems we live in are so short term, helping illuminate how they were created, how did we get to be trapped in these short-term systems, and then shining a light on the people building the new, on the emerging long-time world that is growing all around us, and particularly around here. And so I thought I'd share just a few of the conversations that had nuggets that I really love from the podcast. So one was with Jay Griffiths. I imagine some of you are familiar with her work, author, thinker, nature writer. And when we were talking, she asked me, I think her question was something like, what do you think of when I say the future? And I realized that the first thing I think of when someone says the word future is space. I think of spaceships, I think of a galaxy far, far away, I think of Star Trek. Like, that's what I think of when I think of the future. And Jay was like, yeah, there's no surprise, because we have, as a society, venerated up. We venerated the vertical. But what do you think that does if we think the future doesn't exist on this planet? If when we say the future, we think it exists in space? I mean, it's not great. And so she started to talk to me about how is it to imagine the future is beneath us? How is it to imagine earthy futures? How is it to imagine that the earth itself is the future? How is it to take off your shoes and socks and stand on the ground and know you are standing on the future? So, Jay, the future is down with the worms and woodlice and ants. Then there was a conversation with Tyson Yunkaporta, the Aboriginal scholar, artist, polymath. I had this conversation when I was like 8.5 months pregnant, and I was really, really emotional. I cried a lot. And one of the things he said, well, the first thing he did was he reminded me of something that Pat reminds me of frequently, which is that we are a custodial species. We are not innately destructive. It is so important that we don't conflate capitalism with what it means to be human. We are stewards. And then he said, and perhaps we are in a janitorial moment as a species. Perhaps it's our job to clean the toilets, to wipe the floors, to keep the building in order so that it is there, it is ready, it is clean, it is functioning for those who are coming. And I love this idea of being in a janitorial moment. The humility of it, like the lack of hubris. And then the third conversation that really impacted me was with Adrienne Marie Brown, the futurist, writer, strategist, podcaster. We had a conversation, we were talking about systems and systems change, and she evoked the Grand Canyon, and she talked about imagining all of human history as the Grand Canyon, and imagining that the systems that we live in today, the destructive systems we live in today, capitalism, white supremacy, industrial agriculture, imagining all of these systems as strata in the Grand Canyon of our history. And they're just artifacts. And on top of those strata are the strata of the systems that come after them, the regenerative systems, the systems that serve life. And I love that image. I love that idea of capitalism as artifacts in the Grand Canyon of human history. So those were just some of the nuggets that came from that. And the final piece I want to share was the insight that Deep Time gave me throughout that journey of making the podcast. So, you know, for me, when I think of Deep Time, I think of this place. Stephen Harding has done so much to deepen the work and to share it. But I recently learned that there is a time in history called the Boring Billion. Geologists call it the Boring Billion. There was apparently a billion years when nothing really happened. Like a billion years when nothing really happened. And it was just like smelly, soupy sea for a billion years. And apparently, scientists think that in that billion years, complex life was constantly trying and failing to exist. Trying and failing, trying and failing for a billion years. And then something happened and the tectonic plate shifted a little bit, the weather changed a little bit, and suddenly the conditions were ripe for life. And suddenly we started to have complex life. We started to have lichen. We started to have T-Rexes. We started eventually to have us. But it so easily could not have been. And I am constantly, I'm constantly overwhelmed by how, like, the ecological serendipity of our existence and of this incredible planet. And Brian Eno recently put it really beautifully when he talked about becoming re-enchanted by the improbability of life. And so I think for me, this idea of becoming re-enchanted by the improbability of life is a core principle for what we do. And if we want to look at how to be re-enchanted by the improbability of life, the first place to look is indigenous cultures, because they have been for centuries and centuries understanding this. So that's why I'm so delighted to have had this time teaching with Pat, learning with Pat, and why I am now going to pass the baton over.
Woo! So before I launch in a little bit here, can you tell us a little bit about the award that your podcast won?
Oh, yes.
Please.
Yes, we won the Oscars of podcasting. We won the Radio Academy awarded us Best Independent Podcast of the Year. Mm-hmm. So,
yes. That thrills me. Well, so you can get a little glimpse of how this week has been, this short course of 3 days that felt like a couple of weeks, huh? Yeah, I got students up there going, yeah, that was, we went places, we unearthed and explored many things. So yeah, as Ella's talking, I so wanted to sidle over and get my notebook out as I've been doing all week and just be like, because she's kicking off so many things that come out of the teachings that I received. So one, I wanted to say a word about this red cloth here at the in front of us, and I had some folks come from a long ways to come and visit and bring gifts here, and then some from local people have come also to bring gifts, and I just want to acknowledge that that I'm receiving these gifts on behalf of my elders and the ones that came before me that have given me that preserved knowledge through quite a bit of adversity. Preserved an understanding of being human through quite a bit of adversity and a very rousing bit of attempted assimilation. And so I want to acknowledge that they held fast long enough to be able to pass some of this understanding down to me. And so, as my daughter always says, I'm just here plagiarizing my ancestors. So just that's what this little altar here is for. And thank you so much for those of you who honored that line of thinking. You know, and I had an opportunity this week to play a song. My daughter is Lila June. She also came here and gave an Earth talk at one point, and taught here. But I had a chance to play a song of hers, so you can look that up, Time Traveler. And in it, she says, the singer will die, but the song will go on. The song will travel on. And that's saying a lot about our view of long time. Because, you know, many times we hear from indigenous culture or Native American specifically about seven generations, thinking seven generations, right? And so many times we'll hear it as though I'm standing here and I need to be considering what will my actions mean seven generations down the road. So as I was saying to this week, you know, so If I'm in this room and I'm looking to go from here to here in this room, that seems like a very small movement. But if I'm looking seven generations down the road, that's far, right? So at that point, that small movement expands. So I want us to notice that. And so there's a way of that I witness with my own elders about considering what kind of actions to take. And what are the ethics around the actions that we take, because their impact grows over time and space, right? So I wanted to name that, but this week we've been kind of exploring more what it's like to look at a seven generations perspective from being that middle generation. So I have three generations previous to me. I'm here and I'm thinking about what's going to happen with the next three generations. So I don't know, this is always the gesture that I use for it, but it's like, I'm always traveling like this. I'm not really ever an individual having an individual experience and working for individual gain from that perspective. So this is pretty antithetical to to our modern world paradigm, and it's no accident, I guess I'll say. So just briefly, and many of you have heard me talk about this, about the power over paradigm. That's how another name I give to modern world paradigm, in which you must overpower another in order to have what you need. And so this paradigm is not conducive to cooperation or collaboration or in many ways thinking beyond ourselves or sometimes our nuclear family. And part of the evidence of that is that if we think about how a lot of communities or settlements or cities are made now, is each individual nuclear family must have an entire ecosystem just for itself. So we have a whole ecosystem living next door to a whole ecosystem, you know, so that it's this very siloed way of living. And the earth can't tolerate that, actually. It's not, and this is born out of this particular way of thinking, right? So when I think about that, I see that this long time thinking is this paradigm isn't conducive to long time thinking either. Inherently, because it's driving us to be able to say, I can take care of myself. I can take care of my own. So this seven generations thinking, gosh, there's just so much to think about that comes out of our culture, and I'm just loving having it juxtaposed against what's taking place in Ella's work in the world and bringing it in the way that she's bringing it. But I'm gonna, to one, that the thing that came up for me to talk about is, just mention anyway, is, you know, in our cultures, we talk about our lineage of coming from the stars. That's a very ancient history. That's a long time. That's a long time memory of being human. And so many of our ceremonies will incorporate the Milky Way because we say that's how we traveled. So I don't exactly, I haven't heard an elder say specifically, you know, this is how it happened and this is, you know, but this is mentioned over and over and over again in different cultures all over the world. So that's one thing that I notice is that the measure of human history from indigenous perspective is long. It's much longer than most modern science. And so even as I was listening to the timeline of one version of the history of Earth, in which, you know, one thing we've been talking about this week is time as a vector, a linear movement, moving in one direction, correct? And so there's one version of the story of Earth that talks about this evolution moving forward. And then there's other versions of this long history that's more cyclical, I'm gonna say. Because you may have heard that for many indigenous elders will say that we're in the sixth world now, the fifth world now, or the sixth world now. So what does that say? Let's say that there was world one, two, three, four, five, maybe this is six. So for me, that speaks to a more cyclical way, a way of, and maybe this is also speaking to what you're talking about, Ella, about these attempts at sort of getting it right. These attempts at moving into what I call thriving life paradigm. And so, you know, I think for me, this is more speculation than cultural teaching, but it comes out of the cultural teachings, is I think about, so what does getting it right look like? What can I know about what getting it right looks like? And I think, you know, one, I feel like I've had to consider that this modern world paradigm doesn't have much capacity, let me just put it that way, to acknowledge the profound interrelatedness of all life. It still wants to entertain that different lives can be siloed from each other. Right? And so now we're coming to a time where we're having to recognize, wow, it seems like things happening over here are affecting things happening over there. And that's kind of been imposed upon us. We've been almost unwilling, but now we have to find some willingness to accept, wow, all these systems are so related. And so Thich Nhat Hanh gives us the word interbeing, which I'm always grateful for. So if we are so deeply interrelated, and seemingly, at the same time, we have free will. So to me, this is a great spiritual dilemma. To have free will to do anything we can think of, and yet have to notice at some point here, which I feel like we're coming upon, and this is the teachings that my elders talk about, is everything that we do impacts every other being here. That's how interrelated we are. So I think for me, getting it right, and this has taken time, long time, seemingly, and we've lost worlds in the process of trying to learn and understand about getting it right. I feel like this has become the prayer that I carry at this time, which is to say, you know, how do I become that being that causes all other life to thrive as a five-fingered one? Because as I look around outside at every other living form around us, I feel like that's what I'm witnessing them doing, right? They are not only living in such a way that their own kind is sustained for the next seven generations. You know, I go back to that thing that I always say, what's everything doing out there? It's trying to make more life. It's trying to make more life. It's trying to make more life. So the plan here is life. And so all of these other beings are looking to further the next their next generations. But not only are they doing that, I've had to add this part on, but somehow they're also contributing to the whole, to the well-being of the whole, to their whole ecosystem, to their whole bioregion. So for me, I guess, looking at these long cycles of time, I say to myself, well, then it seems to me that my goal as a being, as an organism here on this earth, that is a part of this deeply interrelated interbeing, I have to figure out how to not only think about furthering my kind, not only myself, my family, my kind, which is already kind of a stretch out of where we are currently, but how do I also live in a way that causes that, where I get to contribute to the health of the whole ecosystem, the whole bioregion in which I'm in. So it's kind of given me a different view about being indigenous, to be of place. And so there's different methodologies even, and we see this in indigenous culture, for how to be that contributor to the well-being of all life in an ecosystem, in a bioregion, on different places on the earth. So it can be very place based. So maybe I'll stop with talking about Lila June's work, and this idea of the strata of human presence. So in her work, she talks about, you know, how they're drilling these core samples into the earth, and the deeper down you go, the farther back in time you go, because you're actually going through the strata of different times of life presence. And so we go back far enough and there might be only a very sparse kind of diversity in a certain time. And then she says, we see human presence arrive, evidence of that. And there's then evidence of this flourishing of biodiversity with the coming of our presence. And to me, that is so nourishing. That's the way in which long time can be a resource for me, is to look at this and say, wow. Because right now, as I've said, I feel like we have low self-esteem as a species. We feel like everything that we touch, we destroy. Well, not so. Not so. And I bet we could find similar core samples and add that same evidence here, and in other places all over the earth, right? So that's one place where long time has really kicked off my imagination and nourished me into thinking about my continent. And I thought, well, you know, she's talking about she's finishing her PhD in traditional land management practices. And we tended to huge regions of earth and cooperated and collaborated, I'm going to say, more than agriculture still has an overbearing kind of tone to it. So I'm going to say cooperated and collaborated to cause life to thrive. So this is something that long time, a gift that long time has given me recently, is looking at how we have been that being. So it's not a pie in the sky idea. It's something that we have known before. And then one of my practices here, since I arrived, it actually happened here in the gardens here in Dartington, but sending my roots down, so asking permission from the earth and asking to send my roots down, and what I I will say that it's different doing that in Europe than it is in what we now call the United States. I feel like to send my roots down here is to go through different layers of human civilization, to go through different layers, a very long history of a certain kind of human civilization and consciousnesses. and so I have to go through strata and strata and strata, because my goal is for my roots to be able to find that feral earth. So just to notice that, and I will say that, you know, I said it in this way of sending my roots down to go through the strata of Western science, to go through and beyond the strata of magic. This was new for me. And then to go down into another kind of consciousness in which the human science that was also working with the medicine, the spiritual, was about aligning with earth movement, seasons, the larger movements of sun and moon, earth and solar system and galaxy, and how the human being contributes to the earth and her destiny, to the earth and her purpose, because she has things she needs to fulfill around here. We get so embroiled in our stuff, we forget. She has things she's got to do. But there have been times when we have participated in her destiny. So maybe I'll stop there.
Great. So now we talk to each other. I think that's what happens.
Yeah.
I wrote some questions.
I've just been talking away. Maybe should I ask you some questions, or are these questions for both of us?
Well, let's see how it goes.
Okay, let's see how it goes.
So the questions are, I mean, so much incredible insight has been being unearthed over these few days. And there are some phrases that have really struck me. So there was one phrase, Pat, that you talked about, which was, what is the grammar of a thriving life for all? What is the grammar of a thriving life for all? Be great if you could talk a little bit about that.
So this is actually coming from an inquiry and a suggestion that an elder of mine, maybe some of you know of his work, Orland Bishop. If not, I highly recommend looking up Orland Bishop. And he's done a lot of work with Charles Eisenstein as well, and many others, but that's some work that I know of. So Orland has been saying, so I've been working in this group that's working to reimagine money and protect the sacred, and it's been amazing work. It's been some of the deepest and best co-creation and collaborative work that I've ever done. But in that context, Orland was saying, you know, we are creating the space, the ability to receive a future. And he says, but this future is actually already here, which goes back to something the Spirit said to me, which is, what if all times are happening at the same time? Then what is possible then? But so Orland says, so the future is actually already here, but we are not entering it yet because we don't have the grammar to perceive it yet. So I'm loving working with this. So what is, so I asked the same question that Ella's asking me, you know, what does that say to you? What does that mean to you? So to me, that's saying that there's ways to, we have to open up our fields of perception. So in that sense, we have to be that fish that leaps out of water long enough to look at the water. And for me, this is where ceremony can be hugely helpful. To be able to perceive in different ways. So what is the grammar of the future? What is the grammar of thriving life paradigm? This would be a question that I would ask. So I don't know if there's more that you want to say about what that question brings up for you.
I love the idea of language that's inherent in it, a grammar. And I think I like it because it makes me think about what the act of communicating is, which is listening. We listen. And ideally we listen first, then we talk. And so it makes me think of how do I need to listen to be able to hear the grammar of a thriving life? How do I attune my listening? How do I develop different kinds of listening? And that's what we've been doing over these days. We've been, one of the things we've been exploring is how do we hear the whispers of future ancestors? And this idea of Pat's that she's just spoken, like, what is, if all times exist at this time, then actually all those future ancestors are here right now. And how do we hear them? How do we hear their shouts, their laughs, their whispers? And I guess that's what we've been exploring. We've been exploring that through different processes, through ceremony, through practices. And I think that's the core of a lot of the work that we do, is there isn't one answer to that question. There's not one way of hearing the whispers of future ancestors. It's almost like for those of us who don't have this in their culture, it's like our muscles, we were really flabby in that bit of our perceiving. That muscle isn't strong within us. And so the more ways we can practice listening to the whispers of future ancestors, the better ancestors we will be.
Right, and I like that, you know, so it's a matter about developing that, because this paradigm hasn't asked that of us, really. But there are human beings who live in other paradigms under the exact same circumstances, needing the exact same things. They need food, clothing, and shelter. They're living under a sky that rains. They're living under they're living with soil that grows, and yet they have decided that going to go about being human on this Mother Earth in a completely different way. So this is something that I'm noticing about a privilege that I have, is to occupy at least two different paradigms, kind of at all times at this point. And that is a huge privilege, because this paradigm hasn't really addressed that for much of the world, I'm gonna say. And so this is part of the reason why I bring Indigenous culture into these spaces, is to say, well, let's consider, you know, if there are human beings that think about being human in a very different way, what does that say about paradigm? It says to me, well, what I hope the message can be is that this isn't the only game in town. Maybe paradigm is a choice. So that's part of the grammar, I think, is to recognize that paradigm is a choice, so that then I can understand, well, what other skill sets would I need? And so not only is there a skill set, so to me, I don't know, but I feel like the languaging of being a good ancestor, or the ancestors to come, that's how I always heard my elders talk about it. It feels like a very Indigenous concept. So we're always reaching out to the ancestors to come. And so there's that muscle of reaching that way, but part of that muscle can be developed by going backwards as well, right? And we spent a little time accessing different wisdom that we wish we knew a little bit more about now. And going back into lineage, which eventually kind of fans out into touching all kinds of lineage, not just one particular kind, not just one race or ethnicity, right? But it begins to branch out as marriages and things happened, right? So eventually it's almost akin to maybe accessing Akashic, what some people call Akashic record, right? But that's all part of this muscle building around the malleability of time. So I have a question. So Ella, you know, we went like way out, and then Ella's work today was to kind of bring us back into anchoring it and thinking about next steps in our lives and where we could bring this. So I guess I'm wondering, Ella, if you could say a couple words about how to find one. So part of what you're looking for is how to bring long time into all different kinds of situations in modern world paradigm and anything that's going on, really, like wherever it isn't, right? And so today you said something that really caught my attention, which is, you know, knowing, like, where are the key moments where you can find opening to assert something like this? So there's long time, but I'm sure there's other things that people would love to be able to insert in different conversations. But what have you learned in this long time process about that strategy?
Yeah, we dived into some different ways of thinking about large scale change today. So one of them was a model that I sometimes find helpful called the Bacana Two Loops model of systems change. Which I'm going to try and show you with my hands.
With my hands.
I did this on radio the other day and it was really hard to describe it. I'm hoping it's going to be a bit easier. But it's going to be back to front. Okay, so let me do it this way. So Bacana Two Loops. So these are the two loops, loop one, loop two. This loop here is the system we're living in right now. It is the declining system, we hope. This is the emerging system here, which goes up really more than my biology will let me, but it kind of goes up. And so when we're seeking to shift systems, there are lots of different places we can seek to do that. So we can seek to, with the existing system, we can seek to help accelerate its decline. We can do that by doing things that campaigners have done awesomely for a long time, which is showing how it's not working, showing how it's broken, showing the fault lines in the system. We can also do that by what is called hospicing the system, helping people who are living and working in that system move to the system that is emerging. But to do that, they have to have a sense that there is a system emerging. And so another really valuable role in this process is midwifing the emergent system. Some of that will be about identifying the outliers who are already building this new system, but they might be isolated and by themselves and unsupported. So how can you bring people together in places like Dartington, which has been doing it very well for a long time? But how do you provide, and actually it was something I wanted us to talk about, this beautiful language that Pat gave me of how do you create these lifeboats of coherence of the system that is emerging? And how do you bring those together so that you have a whole armada of lifeboats of coherence so that you start to feel the momentum of this system that's emerging? And so the work of that is really valuable still. So back down there on the emerging system. But then there's also the really visionary work of shining a light on what could be. Shining a light on the world of the ancestors yet to be born, 100, 200 years time. What could the systems that they're living in, those systems that support life, those systems that support flourishing, thriving life, what could they look like? And so then there is the work of dreaming, of visioning. There's this growing field now here called imagination infrastructure. How do we do that work at scale, en masse, so that the emerging world feels just as real as the dominant system that we're living in? Oh, hello. They're saying, yes, my future. My future. Oh, welcome, little one. So one thing to do is just to be aware and intentional of where in that process your work is, you feel called to work. Is it hospicing? Is it midwifing? Is it visioning? Like, we need all of this. There isn't one right answer. And then I guess part of the strategy of our work is thinking about, so you mentioned about the ability to realize you are living in a paradigm. You know, generally the systems we live in are like water is to fish to us. We cannot see them. They are invisible to us. And that work of revealing, of helping us see we are living a story, of helping us understand that we can author new stories is so powerful. And understanding that it is all a story. Our like catastrophic economic system, which is imploding right now, is a story. Our politics is a story. Our technology is a story. Our law is a story. So helping us really understand that can give us agency to author new stories. And I guess, so our work is, we think about the different places we can intervene where that paradigm shift can have real impact. And so some of that is the work we're doing with governments. Some of that is thinking about how do we work with popular culture? Where are the engine of story in our world? Who are the people being paid billions to tell us stories about who we are and where we should be going? And, you know, it's the ads we scroll through. It is the TV shows we binge. It is popular culture. And so for me, this work is so important to build those bridges. And so that we have our lifeboats of coherence, but we don't stay in them. That we actually take the strength, the vision, the insight that comes from them, and we engage with the engines of in this case, popular culture, so that, you know, we can shift our trajectory. And it's like, It's a delicate dance, you know. It's a delicate dance not to be co-opted, not to be used, to find your work being changed so much that it isn't the work you intended to. Because these systems, these engines, these cultural engines have such dynamism. So it's not an easy, straightforward thing. But yeah, it is a really big part of our strategy. Mm. That was a very long answer.
No, that's great. Thank you. So one thing that I've been learning about creating lifeboats of coherence recently, it's kind of been a school of hard knocks a little bit, but there's been a lot of beauty in it too, is creating the space to have the vulnerability to reveal, you know, so once we're noticing, so in this reimagining money, part of it, you know, this is also, we'll bring in Orland here, where he says, you know, money is the longest and deepest unconscious agreement that humanity has ever made. And so a part of the work is bringing it to consciousness. So it is noticing that I'm a fish and I'm in a certain kind of water, but is that the only water there is? And what are the other possibilities, right? So that process is very revelatory of beliefs, of family dynamic and teaching, generational. You know, I go back to the story of being participating in the language of spirit dialogues in which, you know, we had quantum physicists and linguists and native scholars and traditional knowledge keepers all in dialogue for 4 days. And our instruction was to put down our tacit infrastructure for these 4 days. And it took me 2 years of being in there saying, you know, pretty arrogantly, you think those scientists are going to be able to put down their tacit infrastructures for even a minute? No way, they're not going to be able to do that. And it took me 2 years to realize, and you think an indigenous person is going to be able to put their tacit infrastructure down? No. So yeah, it's such a tender and vulnerable place in some ways to have to live out what long time points to. And so to create a container safe enough to begin to reveal a little bit about what has short-termism led us, where has that led us? It's led us to some really difficult places, and it's led us to some very difficult history, historic choices, historic human movements, historic oppressions, genocides even. And so there for me, there's also feeling this need to be able to, one, be vulnerable, and to also be able to hold vulnerability as we're looking at this and as we begin to think, okay, short-term gain, has led to some very horrific human nature incidents. And on the way to thinking about now, how can we expand and begin to move in a different way with long timeism? So that's something that came up in our conversation at dinner, right here at the White Hart this evening. Yeah.
Yeah, and that leads on to the kind of fierce urgency of this work. It's, and I guess it's a kind of paradox of it. So on the one hand, we are in such perilous times, and all of us in this room hold like billions and billions of future lives in our hands, human and non-human. And like the mindset of urgency that created this problem isn't the mindset that's going to solve it. And so we have this paradox. It is urgent, and urgency might not be the thing that solves it. And so that is a paradox that we've been exploring. And before we go into the next part of the evening, I actually wondered if you could talk a little bit about water and time. We are sitting here drinking our water.
No, that's why I poured your glass first.
Thank you.
Because I said I might have to talk about water,
And so water has ended up being like the third teacher in this course. So Pat, talk to us about water.
So some of you in this room have heard me talk about this, but nevertheless, I want to presence this one here. This holy Mini Wachozane Wakan, this water of life, this one that binds all living things together as one family. And the image that has really been with me lately is thinking about changing all these science books that talk about the water systems and how it's the evaporation from the oceans up to the clouds, and the clouds rain down on the mountains, and the rivulets turn into streams, which run into rivers, which run back into oceans. Complete. Well, not by a long shot. Because first, or somewhere in there, this water passes through every single life form. Imagine. Every form of life consciousness. Every form of life experience. All the strategies, actually, for thriving life paradigm, all the strategies for how to be a being that causes all other life to strive, to thrive and strive. Well, that's something that's really been striking me lately. What it is to drink this water, and not just from recent life forms, but from the ancestors of all life. So I say all of our ancestors had a drink of this very water right here. But not only our ancestors, the ancestors of the flying ones, swimming ones, creepy crawly ones, four-legged ones, standing nation. And Ella says her little one really enjoyed the notion that Tyrannosaurus Rex drank from this water right here. Fascinating. Fascinating. That billion years of primordial stew where life was trying. This was the amniotic fluid for it. All those attempts, all those moving through worlds, first world, second world, third world, fourth world, fifth world, sixth world. This one was present for quite a lot of it, if not all of it. So we have this timekeeper, not only life, but alive. My elders say it has consciousness. And so it's listening even to our evening here, you know, and taking note. The status report on the human presence at Dartington Hall on this particular evening. And we'll send it out to the rest of the life to consider. So I feel like as I walk by this beautiful garden, as I walk by each of the plants in the ecosystem that has been created here, they know a little bit about me. They know a little bit about us, and they know how to send me something, I believe,
You know, I had such a profound meeting with the grandmother Yew Tree when I returned here. Just dropped me. She dropped me right to my knees. Because I've had so many experiences of sharing my concerns, sharing my overwhelm, sharing what Spirit's outrageous proposition is to me now. Always an outrageous proposition. And where I'm at in the process of trying to be an agent for that proposition. And that grandmother Yew Tree knows how to touch me and soothe me and help me. She's seen a lot also. So we say that this water, the air, the fire, it's seen it all. And so I say this water's faith is incorruptible in persevering towards life, towards creating that unified consciousness of thriving life. And so when our faith is flagging and flickering, we can always turn to this one and lean on the faith of this water and ask for that help. So thank you for giving me that opportunity to presence this timekeeper, this time traveler that flows through and among us and will also flow out to the ancestors to come. This water will nourish them. This consciousness that we're expressing here in this room, this opening into a new grammar of thriving life, will reach them and nourish them. So, all my relations.
So, we are now going to dive into the long time together in a slightly more embodied way. So I invite you to rustle in your seat a little bit to get yourself comfortable, shift around, and then to slowly let your eyes blink to close. To feel the ground beneath your feet. To start to become aware of the breath moving in and out of you. And to arrive fully present in this moment. I invite you to bring to mind an older person that you've cared about. It could be a grandparent, a great aunt or uncle, or an older person of that generation. And as you're thinking of them, think of a quality that they have that evoke warmth for you. It could be something that made them laugh, a funny habit they had, a smile. Think of a quality that evokes warmth for you. And in your mind's eye, step backwards one step. You're stepping back through the generations. And for a moment, imagine this person at 40. How is this quality that evokes warmth for you present in them at 40? And now, taking another step backwards in your mind's eye, you arrive at their 9th birthday party. Where in the world is this happening? Where are you? Who's in the room? Who's celebrating? What are they eating? Take a moment to connect with the 9-year-old. How is this quality that evokes warmth in you present in them at 9? When is this happening? It might be the 1910s, 1920s, maybe a bit earlier. Maybe a bit later. You walk over to a window and for a moment you turn your back on the party. What do you see out of the window? What was the world like back then? You hear a noise, it brings you back to the party, you turn around, And for a moment, you drink it all in, this celebration. And then you take your leave. And in your mind's eye, you step forward one step and another step back to this moment. Slowly let the image of that older person fade from your mind's eye and feel the support of the ground beneath you. And your breath moving in and out. Now I invite you to bring to mind a little person you care about. It could be a child, a grandchild, a niece, a nephew, the children of friends. Again, think of a quality that they have that evokes warmth for you. It could be their smile, a funny habit they have, something that makes them laugh. And in your mind's eye, now step forward one step. You're stepping forward through the generations. And imagine this person at 40. How are they at 40? How is that quality that evokes warmth for you present in them then? Now you're stepping forward one more step through the generations and you've arrived at this person's 90th birthday. It is a form of great celebration. There is much merriment. Take a moment to connect with this person at 90. How are those qualities that evoke warmth for you present in them at 90? For a moment, you walk over to the window, leaving the party behind you. When is this happening, this party? It might be the end of this century, start of the next one. Might be a bit earlier, might be a bit later. What do you see outside of the window? What is the world like in the future? You hear a noise that brings you back to the party and you see the person celebrating their 90th is tapping their glass. And then you notice that there is a photo of you on the table. And the person celebrating their 90th taps their glass and asks everyone to make a toast. And they're toasting you. They're toasting you for something that you've done to help make their world better. What are they toasting you for? Take some moments to connect with your legacy. And now it's time for you to take your leave again. You say your farewells, and in your mind's eye, you step back one step through the generations and another to arrive back in this moment. Slowly let the image of the person fade from your mind's eye. Again, connect to your breath moving through you. Connect to the support of the earth beneath you and the space of the air above you. And remind yourself of this unique place between earth and sky that you occupy, for the unique time that you will occupy it. And when you're ready, slowly blink your eyes open. You've just traveled maybe about 200 years backwards and forwards, or maybe round in a spiral. How did that feel? How does it feel to do as Pat spoke about, to situate yourself in the middle of seven generations? So we invite you to turn to the person next to you. Ideally, if it's someone you don't know, that is good. But if that's not possible, you can do it with a friend. And you're just going to spend a couple of minutes just sharing how that was, what came up for you. And I'll let you know when we're done. So.
It is. New things are arising even when we're sitting here.
Let's find ways. I think so.
Yeah, I'd be curious about bringing some of your long time work into the Reimagining Money part. That's, in theory, that's not a place that's resistant to finding unusual resistance. I wish it was, but
always.
Yeah, I think it would be interesting to add that because an element. So my grand grandfather, he said time is the fifth element.
And it's fun to start off with a spoken word artist who talks about Pumpkin House music. And we begin to talk a very serious episode about economics and people talking about that is how you talk about it. It was the one I've always been very scared of. As a field, kind of perpetuating like an exclusivity.
Talk about grammar, right?
And it was such a revelation to be like, oh, it's not math. Economics is math. It's about being fine.
Yeah, I have this fantasy about getting together with a group of people. I'm actually tempted at my having say it, but to really unpack what are we talking about when we say economy? Actually, we're talking about all of our life. But because that word kind of sews it all up in its own grammar, like Latin, then we shy away from it and we concede to it. It's like a thing beyond our understanding, but actually it's right here in the clothes I'm wearing, where this water came from. So I'm going to have a serious unpacking of the word, sort of storming the tower.
She's the woman who wrote Donut Economics.
Okay.
And she is, I find her so powerful. She takes down the economics and suggests this is Donut, which is a system, a way of doing economics. And where the economics is supposed to be driving life, actually. And now they've got this Donut Economics Action Lab, which is supporting things that start developing donuts. One of the things she says, she's in that episode, but she says a few, just many lovely things. One of them she says is that this century's economics can be lived first and the big rise later. I love that idea. It's perfect. That's what we thought about 10 minutes of our show. Great.
So that's what I say, that is the beauty of this time, is we're going to find out what works, and we're not going to have to contend with all random theories necessarily, because a lot of them are just going to be wiped out in practice, so similar.
Yeah. Should we bring Jeanette? Okay, everyone, if you could bring your conversations to a close. And we're now going to have an opportunity to hear from you.
So do
ask us any questions, share any insights you have about being a good ancestor or about the long time. Over to you. Maybe raise a hand. That might help.
I would be interested also in hearing anything if there was surprising about what the toast to you was about, mm-hmm. if you were surprised to know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think over here, yes.
What is your name?
Aguasantas.
Mm. Aguasantas.
Name.
What a name.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, the back.
Yeah, hi. I'd like to ask a question. I'm really grateful to you for bringing this perspective, and I can feel the impact of it on my nervous system. Can you hear me well?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. On my nervous system. And what arises for me is a question around what is stopping me or us to live in that paradigm, you know, in my days. And I also think of my nervous system and fear. The survival, the immediate drive to get enough, you know, which creates the sense of scarcity and closes my long view. I just wonder how you engage with that, because it's very safe in this room, but when suddenly all the electricity is turned off, and you know what I'm saying, I can imagine loads of disturbance in my village, and I'd like to be prepared, and I'm also curious about this, the theme of shock and survivalism and the long-term view.
I'll work with that. Thank you, and thanks for ringing in the nervous system. I'm doing all kinds of work with my nervous system this year. It's the year of the nervous system for me. Noticing, which is why I haven't been doing a whole lot of traveling, but I had to come to Devon. So this kind of brings me back to this idea of the lifeboats of coherence. Right. So and that's actually a concept that was introduced to me by Joseph Chilton Pierce in his book, The Biology of Transcendence. But he talks about how, you know, when collapse happens, when the chaos happens, and then when it goes to rebuild, it's going to rebuild around coherence. So he gave the example of Poland, that there was a network of farmers that had relationships. What do you mean by coherence? In that case, relationship, cooperation, collaboration. I don't feel like their way was siloed individual ecosystems. It was kind of a shared ecosystem, community ecosystem. And so when Poland gets collapsed again through war, when it begins to rebuild, it begins to rebuild around this system of the farmers. and their coherence. So this is an idea that I really hold on to, because I think in that book he's suggesting, you know, rather than continuing to try to find that lever long enough to change the whole thing all at once, that that something that we can all participate in is creating these lifeboats of coherence. So, or armadas, preferably, of coherence. And I like that, because when I think of those lifeboats of coherence, I feel like they're sort of passively waiting amongst themselves. But I hear you describe it as there's kind of racing out to sea to different situations, you know, thrusting coherence upon situation, perhaps, which I kind of like that, you know. So I think for me, yeah, I feel like my nervous system is leading me to understand what coherence means to it or me, and then to communities around, just creating places where my nervous system can be at peace, where I can have a chance to consider, where I'm not under threat. So that's also that place of creating containers where vulnerability can be, where unpacking what has happened and where it has, you know, what the influences have been and where they've led us. So I don't know, that's what I know to say about it is just, for me, that's been a very powerful idea. And right now I'm being called to take stewardship of about 139 acres of land at the base of one of our four sacred mountains. So here I've been zooming around the world for 15 years, and now it's like, now you're gonna root right here at the mountain. And so I'm learning about what that coherence is gonna mean there. What does it mean to create coherence? And for me in that situation, it's listening deeply to what is the mountain asking for? And you'll hear more about that to come.
Yeah, and I think kind of really acknowledging that the short-term systems we live in will keep us trapped and feeling overwhelmed and keep our nervous systems in a state of constant electricity. And that is part of how they function. And so understanding how to step out of that is a revolutionary act. And right now it feels harder than ever. I mean, my God, like at the moment, every day, it's like, how can we even think about next month? We don't know what tomorrow's gonna bring, let alone next year, let alone 10 years, let alone 100 years. And yet it's at times like these that is more important than ever. If we don't find ways of building those islands of coherence, what insane chaos will take their place. And so it's there feels like there's some paradoxes within all of this. That's with all good things. Any other questions, comments? Yeah.
Thank you. I was wondering, with your two-loop model, how you saw the role of ceremony, ritual, and sort of more deeper systemic reparation work, bringing communities together, from maybe perpetrators who have polluted certain areas, or, you know, basically elders that are looking after certain areas as well, how that can help form systemic change.
You're asking such great questions.
I think maybe you just defined our next endeavor together.
Do you want to take that?
I guess I'll just say that so in terms of hospicing collapse, I see ceremony there to hold, to bring in the elements, to bring in what is stabilizing, what has been stabilizing, and then and also temperance in ourselves. You know, there's this thing that I've been saying for a little while about how we do actually, I think, have to prepare for peace and war simultaneously. War meaning being prepared to take a stand, to declare what we consent to, what we do not consent to, give our consent to. And then, you know, so there's been these oppositions between, for instance, you know, profit, money profit, and profit, life profit, these two kind of being pitted against each other. But as Earth changes come, that willingness a willingness is arising that we haven't seen from different parts of our human community. And so there's transition and change happening, whereas people who've been like, no, I'll never change, and then all of a sudden they're like, okay, tell me what to do. So on the one hand, we're like poised like this, and in the next moment, we have to be able to catch them when they fall and hold on to them. So to me, ceremony is a huge part of being able to cover that range. It takes spiritual strength to be able to flip and not hold the grudge or not do the I told you so, or, you know, to really begin to bring it into, okay, great. So now we have someone else that's really willing to create a lifeboat of coherence. And then there's, in the Lakota culture, there's the visioning. So that front edge of innovation, like some of you have heard me say, I've had it with brilliance and genius from human beings. I want to be led by the rest of life. I want to be led spiritually also. And so to me, that ceremony part is really critical in that leading edge of creativity.
I think we need to stop. I think we have been going for quite a long time. It's such a shame. And I wish we could stay here into the night. But it is late. There is one question, yes, at the front.
There's a part of me that is a sort of simple shamanic type of human being wanting to relate to where I live, to my environment. When I did my travel backwards with my father, who lived on the South Downs in a village and worked with the horses on the farms. So I have this awareness of my environment, and I live in a village nearby. And I have always felt that relationship to where I live. It's been quite difficult, but it's something I think we all have to work at. I happen to be a member of the Badger Trust, and the post I got this morning was that over 200,000, they're being wiped out. This is an animal that has been on this land for over 500,000 years, an ancient species. And because of the way everything in our society is moving along, not a lot of people know this. The post today was the whole areas, these animals are becoming extinct. Mm. And the government is granting more licenses for more people to go out and wipe them out. And the science is even questionable, as a lot of us know. Mm-hmm. What do I do with that? How do I handle that deep grief in my way of being? Because it feels like I can't do anything. It feels like all I can do is pray. But I want to do more. I want to maybe write or sing a song or kind of express myself, because I have feel so much empathy with this species that has lived on this land for so long, and I feel part of the land as well. Mm-hmm. And this feels very much in line with what Pat talks about.
Mm-hmm. Not Badger. Not Badger. Well, you know, here I can go to something. It's a methodology that's a little bit experimental, maybe, because, you know, our peoples. You know, I'm sitting here a survivor of attempted genocide. My daughter says that the wisdom that we know of indigenous cultures is the ravaged, traumatized remnants of knowledge that was held. That's actually what we get to encounter and experience in the world today. So all these languages are being lost, And these languages hold some of the deepest science and understanding of sustainability that has ever existed. Well, I don't know, I can't say ever, but has that we know of, that has existed in the human library of understanding of how to be on Earth. And every day these languages are disappearing. So I understand that kind of grief from that perspective. And I want to keep standing up and saying it should matter to all of us what's happening to Indigenous knowledge and Indigenous language. But one thing that we say that helps our hearts is to say that the language actually emerged out of the earth itself, herself. And so, you know, I say culture isn't a human construct. Culture is the Mother Earth expressing herself as human being in any given place. And so we wear her in these different places. And so that gives me comfort around the languages. The languages, like the grammar of the future, is humming on the earth and here. So that helps me with that kind of loss. And the other thing I can point to is the buffalo in what we now call the United States. I mean, that got almost completely rubbed out. But it's our love, our longing, our songs, and our ceremony have brought them back. They're coming back strong now. And they're even roaming all the way down into Mexico. There's huge herds of buffalo down in Mexico now. The herds are being, you know, some are being culled in this very bizarre way. But now different indigenous tribes are remaking themselves and also acquiring land through with the cooperation and collaboration of wealth holders to be able to accommodate the herds again. So they can come down to being almost gone, but I think our part of it is our holding of them and our long relationship with them can bring them back. So I just offer that as, like I say, some kind of experimental experience with such losses that hurt the heart so deeply. And it ain't over till it's over.
Yeah, and maybe the songs or the writing you might want to do, maybe that's not actually you. Maybe that's the badgers speaking. Maybe those thoughts you have aren't your thoughts, they're the badgers' thoughts. And so maybe it's not on you to ignore them, or you know, how is it if it's them trying to speak through you to protect them? How what does that make possible? Well, obviously we would love to stay here all night, but we can't. So a huge thank you to Dartington for having us, for making this possible. A huge thanks to the amazing students on the short course who are here, who all of them should have been on this stage with us, because their wisdom has been extraordinary this week. And Pat, a huge thank you for the collaboration and the dance.
Yes, and a new collaborative sisterhood is born.
Great, thank you.